When I was a boy, I believed that the sea was boundless and indestructible to human pressures.
There was no fish living there because they had
now I know better.
As a nation, if we're undermining the traditional maritime...
Most of the biggest fish have been harvested, and there are places where jellyfish have become the catch of the day.
And you start taking away somebody's rights and liberties, there's going to be a moment of truth for everybody.
Everybody says, put it out there.
Most of the world's coral reefs are bleached or dying.
Just get it out of my sight.
There are dead zones the size of small states off our coasts.
The government's gonna do it.
And all at a time when we have to deal with aquaculture, wind and wave energy, even oil and gas exploration that are staking claims in our waters. But I have also learned there's a smarter, more lasting course than the one we're on.
In 2010, the United States adopted its first ever National Ocean Policy, a policy that now calls for bringing together people from across the societal spectrum to carry out a new, far-sighted strategy for sustaining the country's ocean, coasts, and Great Lakes. It is founded on a branch of conservation, more formally known as ecosystem-based management, more simply, as a common sense approach to preserving life. It is backed by science and based on the needs of the human community in balance with that of its ecological provider, the sea.
So we have things that happen right here in Iowa that end up affecting folks thousands of miles away, fishermen trying to fish in the Gulf of Mexico.
Shipping is extremely important to this economy. 1 in 8 jobs in Southern California is associated with the port activity, and then nationwide it's between 3 and 4 million jobs. So I see marine spatial planning as a tool that will help ports delineate the area where traditional maritime uses are going to be protected.
Scientific research.
Do we need it?
We're finally getting it, thanks to our reserve.
If it's not too late.
No, it's not too late.
I said if.
Yes, it's not.
To meet some of the movement's pioneers, we will journey from coast to coast, as well as the land between. From the fishing community of Port Orford, Oregon, to farmers along the Mississippi River, to the Gulf of Mexico. From divers in the Florida Keys to whale researchers and industrial shippers in Massachusetts Bay. All are now practicing a new philosophy of marine stewardship, of prosperity through preservation.
We're now inside the Stellwagen Bank National Marine Sanctuary. This is 850-some square mile marine protected area off the coast of Massachusetts, and it's an extremely productive area, one of the most productive areas in the Gulf of Maine.
She might come up right here again. You can just drift forward a little. She might come up again.
Stellwagen Bank is a place of unusual richness, a mixing bowl of upwelling currents and nutrients that feed multitudes of fish and seabirds, marine mammals, and people. When in 1992, Stellwagen Bank became a National Marine Sanctuary, it inherited a long and busy history of boat traffic. The sanctuary's waters are plied by all forms of vessels, and that has posed a growing challenge for the largest and oldest residents of Stellwagen.
Well, the problem that we're trying to deal with in this particular piece is really North Atlantic right whales and humpback whales and finback whales, all these endangered species, being struck and killed by large commercial vessels. By that I mean ships that are 300 gross tons or more.
There's more and more cargo ships going in different directions from overseas and up and down the coastline. There's a lot of recreational uses, there's commercial uses. A lot of demand for wind power to be done out on the ocean. We now have two offshore liquefied natural gas terminals off the coast of Boston.
Knowing that some of the rarest whales in the world were dying in the shipping lanes of Boston Harbor, the Massachusetts Port Authority, Dave Wiley, and the shipping industry together set out to save them. The most immediate questions were simple to ask, yet hard to answer. Where do the whales feed? Where do they congregate? Where are the commercial ships traveling, and how fast? The answers eventually came by way of millions of little bits of data.
All vessels 300 gross ton or larger are required to carry an AIS system, or automatic identification system, that was developed between us and the Coast Guard. And the way that we've done this is we've set up three antennas across the sanctuary, and the idea is that we can triangulate and get full coverage throughout the entire sanctuary. So what happens is a ship comes through the shipping lane or any other parts of the sanctuary. It transmits a signal every 2 to 10 seconds, giving its ship information plus also its latitude, longitude, and speed, and where it's heading, and what type of vessel it is.
Stellwagen's lab collected more than 150 million records each year, pinpointing all the large ships within the sanctuary.
Coming towards us.
Determining the whale's whereabouts required different skills.
Okay. The other one is still on the left, even though the flipper's over the back of it. I'm saying you don't want to tag the belly up one. You want to keep coming up, Alex, just like this. Just like this. Okay, right, okay. Good placement. Wait till she brings her back up. You're right on the right spot. Let her bring it up. Let her bring the back up. Let her bring the back up now.
Out.
Perfect. Yeah. Perfect.
To track the whales, Wiley and his crew employed a new device called a D-tag, a miniature computer harmlessly fastened to the whales with suction cups.
Come to the left, down. Perfect!
Oh man,
beautiful.
Wow.
Very beautiful. All right.
When the tag detaches from the whale, a radio beacon leads scientists to its location to retrieve it. The D-tag has granted us a far more intimate picture of the whale's underwater world. This animation is based on the information gathered from the D-tag. Here we see the feeding behavior of humpback whales as it has rarely been seen before.
But the D-tag allows us to get down to the bottom and see that, in fact, they are doing this sort of rolling behavior and feeding on what you're seeing here, which is the sandlands right along the bottom, sometimes during the day, mainly at night. And superimposed in here is some fixed fishing gear, which you'll see here is a gill net, and then also the surface lines going up to the surface. So as you can see, this animal did a really good job avoiding the potential entanglement.
Other whales are not so lucky. North Atlantic right whales are found typically feeding near the surface at a depth of 15 to 20 meters or less. 15 meters is also the keel depth of large vessels entering the port of Boston, putting whales into strike range. With as few as 350 members of its kind remaining, the death of even a single breeding female can tip the species towards extinction.
So one of the next things we wanted to look at is how serious of a problem is this? So another visualization here is showing you, again, the sanctuary is dropped into 3D here, and these are nautical mile grid cells. And the height of the each of the cells that you're seeing is, in fact, the dense areas where there's the most population of whales.
Thompson and Wiley overlaid the shipping lanes and saw a collision waiting to happen.
There were also areas in the sanctuary that were less used by whales. So we decided it'd be a good idea, very smart, to try to move the shipping lanes from areas that whales used a lot to areas that the whales used with much less frequencies.
Wiley took his idea of moving the shipping lanes to the port operators group, presenting his data and offering solutions that were good for the whales. But were they good for the shippers?
Our initial response to the proposed shift in the traffic lanes was guarded, and then we had some concerns for navigational safety.
It was the first time that, you know, we'd ever been approached that at that level in that detail to figure out what was going on the ocean. You know, you can't manage it if you don't know who's out there and what they're doing.
About barge on the right channel. Is that about a scanner, man?
With a clearer picture of all the pieces, both the shipping industry and the whale champions realized their needs were not so incompatible after all.
They'd have some more questions, we'd rework the data, and after about 6 months, we came to an agreement of what we thought would be a particular configuration for the shipping lanes that would give us very good conservation benefit for right whales and the other endangered whales, and also would have minimal impact upon the shipping industry.
The lane was shifted north to come in a direction like this. This would represent what the new shipping lane looks like as opposed to the old one. And there have not been any incidents, so.
The last thing that we want to do is to harm one of the animals with a ship. And nobody wants to do that. The shippers don't want to do that. The pilots don't want to do that when they're on the ship. So we want to take the steps and re-educate the captains and everybody involved so that that risk is reduced, yeah.
There's been close to 100% compliance with the ships following the voluntary lanes, and I think that's testimony to how much the industry really embraced it.
Boston became the first port in the nation to change its shipping routes to protect marine mammals, reducing the whale's risk of being struck by more than 80%. But there would be little time for celebration.
Because at the same time we were moving the shipping lanes, the liquid natural gas companies, through the Deepwater Port Act, were working to put two deepwater ports just a few miles from the sanctuary border and in the area that we were moving the shipping lanes to. Now, you can't have shipping lanes and deepwater ports coexisting. So now we had in conflict a project that was very important for endangered whale conservation, and of course, the LNG, very important to the nation for energy independence and security.
Well, Excelerate Energy looked at the market in the Northeast U.S. as far as there was a great energy need here. And we have a solution to bring an incremental supply of natural gas to the Northeast. And that's where we developed the Northeast Gateway Deepwater Port. We knew coming in that the whales would be an issue.
So I got this phone call from these guys at Excelerate going, hey, you know what? Time is money. Every day we're not in the water, that's costing me $1 million and people sitting around waiting to start building this terminal. Fix it.
Again, the questions to Stellwagen's dilemma would eventually be answered by the whales and an alliance of people willing to listen.
Hey,
for in fact the whales were speaking amongst themselves, as were most of the creatures of the sea. A phenomenon of vital underwater chatter that humanity had only lately begun to decipher.
Well, there are no deaf marine vertebrates. Fish, they're all hearing. Whales, they're all hearing. Now we're discovering that all the invertebrates, the lobsters and the crabs and the shrimp, they're all doing it too. In the ocean, everybody's listening to sound and most everybody's making sounds.
Right whales make this particular call called the right whale up call. It kind of goes whoop, and that's a call that they use for contacting each other.
To make sure that no whale would go unheard, Accelerate Energy financed a network of acoustic buoys in the middle of Boston's shipping lanes. With Cornell's bioacoustic know-how, Woods Hole engineers, and Stellwagen's marine biologists all on board, the unlikely collaboration developed the nation's first ever acoustic whale detection system.
As soon as the vessel enters the shipping lane, we reduce our speed to 12 knots or less. We put personnel on the bridge of the vessel, and they start generally scanning for marine mammals.
We made it work. We can now listen to the ocean. We have a network of these buoys right in the middle of the shipping lanes. And these are positioned about 10 miles apart, so they overlap, and they can listen for whales throughout this area.
So this has given Cornell an opportunity to do things that they've not been able to do by having an array and having year-round funding. And it won't surprise me if Dr. Clark doesn't find a way to develop a network that will reach further than Boston Harbor. I'm hoping that, you know, we'll have some part in that in the future.
All the people in that group came away being a little bit different as a result of the process. You know, certainly the conservationists and scientists could understand the industry point of view a little bit better. Certainly industry could understand the science better and the conservation need. So if we work together on something in the future, which I'm sure we will and we actually are, I think it'll go about a bit easier. We have more confidence in each other to act in a straightforward and honest manner, I think, at this point.
Those looking to save whales and support industry in Massachusetts Bay have converged on a surprisingly painless solution. Rarely, though, does the intersection of ocean stewardship and societal demands flow so smoothly. And nowhere has the challenge been so deeply tested than in America's most beloved coral reef. The Florida Keys are the fossilized tips of a vast coral kingdom, an oceanic rainforest sheltering creatures of every color in the rainbow. But also they are an ever busier playground and workplace of sightseers and divers, sailors and fishermen. Twenty years ago, a fisherman of the Florida Keys named Billy Causey took what would amount to the leap of a lifetime. Causey went from earning his living catching fish to protecting those same fish as the first manager of the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary. The response from Causey's own community has come to symbolize the rough waters of marine conservation in a world of competing uses.
Billy was, in this hemisphere, probably hated to the with the locals as much as Castro was to the Miami Latins. And at that time, there was a lot of public angst. I mean, everybody saw it as a restriction of their rights and liberties to go out and fish whatever they wanted to, whenever they wanted to, wherever they wanted to. And you start taking away somebody's rights and liberties, there's going to be a moment of truth for everybody.
The process got so contentious in 1992 that I was hung in effigy. And I don't really like to talk about that because it was a tough day for me.
So I was part of the crowd with the rope and the crosses at first outside of Billy Causey's window when they hung him in effigy.
As you can imagine, people, first they were concerned about all of a sudden this big federal footprint that surrounded their community. They were concerned about what a sanctuary was going to do to their livelihoods.
While the very idea of a sanctuary struck the Keys fishermen as disaster, Causey saw it as their greatest hope. With some 4 million sightseers, divers, and sport fishermen pouring more than $1 billion every year into the Keys economy, cooperation became the most obvious salvation for all.
14 on the starboard, another throwable life ring.
I used to get calls by the dive operators who would be complaining about the charter fishing boats that would troll close to the reef, and their fish would get hooked on and they would wrap around divers. And I would get calls from families that were upset that people were spearfishing right next to them at one of the reefs. Or I'd get calls from dive charter boats who had tropical fish collectors collecting right on the top of the reefs where they were. So there were all these conflicts in these areas.
Causey forged ahead, forming the nation's first Sanctuary Advisory Council, bringing in representatives of all that had a stake in the health of the Keys. The council's solution was to partition the Keys' most critical areas. Borrowing some time-tested techniques from Australia's Great Barrier Reef, the council adopted a special set of marine zones to protect the sensitive reefs from overuse and to separate conflicting uses. And ironically, in separating the people, it brought them together.
Protecting sensitive marine areas, that seems to cover a lot of the concerns.
Bringing people together to talk about a problem is step one. I can only speak from my experiences here and how it was done here, and it was done right. Everybody's involved, and everybody gets to hear what everybody has to say.
At a minimum, work to get...
It works out fine for us. I don't know any charter boat fishermen here that would say that the sanctuary preservation areas have hurt their business. I don't know anybody that would say that.
This is a large project. We authorize
it. Was I right? Was I wrong? Anybody who doesn't revisit a decision that you have a question about, it makes a big mistake in life. So I revisited that decision and said, well, maybe it was the right thing because I'm still catching fish here. I'm not fishing there, but I'm still catching fish there. So what did it really take away from it? So is it really hurting me? No. And if it does some good, so much the better. And then when you see that it does some good, you said, hey, maybe we should close some other areas.
Protecting both their businesses and the ecosystem, in 2001, the Sanctuary Advisory Council established the No-Take Tortugas Ecological Reserve. At that time, the largest fully protected marine area in the country.
Now, what's really exciting is that the tortugas, which are to the west of us from right here about 70 miles, are upstream of the Florida Keys. As the current moves between us and Cuba, a series of counterclockwise gyres spin off. And anything spawning in the tortugas is spread in the larvae. So those larvae are carried all the way up the Keys, and then they're sprinkled into the grass beds, into the nursery areas. They grow up there, they move out to the reefs, and they start spawning again. This past year, we saw the reestablishment of a fish spawning aggregation site, which were mutton snapper, a very important species to the fishing community here in the Keys. And they're back in huge numbers, which is a huge success.
It
really worked out, you know, in our best interest that they're protecting these resources, because what they protect helps us in the long run. We all work together and, you know, we do what's best for the environment. If it makes sense, the fishermen are for it. If it doesn't make sense to us, you know, we could have a problem with it. But in general, you know, we hash these things out and we try and do what's best for the resources.
We have seen a turn in this community, and we've seen people that realize that we're not going to put them out of business. Our job is to keep them in business. Our job is to make sure that these groups have something here in the future to make a living off.
For Causey and the keepers of the keys, all have begun to realize that the fate of their beloved reefs is far more than a Florida affair.
The good and bad all flow with the water currents that come to the Keys. And I also have to be looking over my shoulder upstream at the Mississippi River and 40% of North America that drains into the Gulf of Mexico.
The Gulf of Mexico, terminus of America's mightiest river, incomparable cradle of life, drawing millions of migrating birds, and the nation's greatest nursery of fish. Yet after decades of neglect, the Gulf has come to symbolize loss. Twice, it has recently served as bullseye for the costliest hurricane and the largest oil spill in U.S. history. Its longer history describes a more insidious decay. Its wetlands vanishing by the minute. Its waters seasonally rendered dead for lack of oxygen. The insults to the Gulf come from all quarters. Dredges and channels have diverted the mighty Mississippi from the wetlands it once nourished. A gauntlet of industries and cities lining the river's banks have discharged their pollutants, destroying the marsh's seafood nurseries, expanding the dead zone to record size. But just as there are many to blame for the demise of America's greatest coastal wetland, so too there are many rescues now underway to reverse it. One in particular comes from an unlikely team of people in an unlikely place.
My name is Dennis Friest. I'm at Radcliffe, Iowa, Central Iowa. We have a family farm operation. We have about 1,450 acres of row crops, and we farrow to finish about 4,500 pigs a year, and we also finish an additional 5,000 feeder pigs a year.
Iowa farmers are blessed with some of the most productive soils in the world, producing 23 million acres of corn and soybeans. Almost every acre is put to use, producing food and energy.
Some people say, well, what does Iowa have to do with the Gulf of Mexico or the ocean anyway? And we say, well, about 200 million gallons every minute. The Mississippi River has a drainage from 31 states. what happens in Iowa, what happens in Nebraska, in Idaho, in West Virginia, that happens to the ocean. There's an enormous impact.
Once covered by tall grass prairie and roamed by millions of bison, the Midwest has become a landscape of industrial agriculture. With this monoculture have also come great quantities of excess nutrients in the form of nitrogen and phosphorus, now leaching from Midwestern soils into the Mississippi River and ultimately into the Gulf of Mexico. Here, these wayward fertilizers feed immense blooms of algae, whose decaying masses deplete the ocean water of oxygen, every year creating a dead zone the size of Massachusetts, suffocating nearly everything in its path.
So we have things that happen right here in Iowa that end up affecting folks thousands of miles away, fishermen trying to fish in the Gulf of Mexico. As we start to figure out how to do a better job, we can lessen that amount of phosphorus that leaves our farms and lessen that amount of nitrogen that leaves our farms. It's something that we can do and been starting to improve, and I think we have some more that we can get done on that.
To witness firsthand what it was they were hoping to save, a group of Iowa farmers, led by Secretary of Agriculture Bill Northey, boarded a southbound bus and followed their Mississippi River downstream to its meeting with the Gulf of Mexico.
I've been doing this for 20 years. I don't think I've had Iowa farmers on a boat. I've had just about everybody else, from rock stars to country music singers to Oklahoma tourists, but no Iowa farmers.
Taking the bait, but not taking the hook.
I guess I didn't realize the value of it as far as the fishing industry and that sort of thing, how important it is.
Good day.
I'm basically a fish out of water down here, aren't I? Interesting experience.
If someone had asked me a year or so ago if I would be working with the Commissioner of Agriculture for the state of Iowa and taking him out on a boat this past weekend, I would have said no. There's no way that's going to be happening, but it is, and that's a good thing.
Okay. So you're holding back here?
Yes, sir, right here behind.
Wow, they
here.
Are sandy field.
Got them.
Rough field to them. Yeah.
It shows that people throughout this country understand that we need to work together to solve problems that extend well beyond the boundaries of our state. The resources that we manage, our fish, our shrimp, they don't know where state lines are.
The governors of the five states bordering the Gulf of Mexico came to realize that each of their economic futures hinged on the health of the same system. Their agreement to preserve that system became the Gulf of Mexico Alliance.
Basically try to move from a system of state-by-state governance of the Gulf of Mexico to one on a more regional basis. And we've extended that partnership up into the watershed of the Mississippi River. We're talking about not just doing things differently when you get on your tractor or in your pickup truck in Iowa, we're talking about thinking about things differently.
One of the farmers' experiments is aiming to lighten their heavy reliance on fertilizer. The entrepreneurial Dennis Friest was one of the first farmers to take the leap, reducing his fertilizer dose substantially.
And we weren't losing any yield. So it was really an eye-opener to say that we are being told by our retailers and industry that we need so much nitrogen to produce a bushel of corn. We're finding out that that was on the high side, and that extra pounds we were putting out were actually going to waste, and we're going ending up in the Gulf of Mexico in the hypoxia zone.
Number one, it's about the environment, but number two, it's also about economics. We're not leaching that nutrient away. We use less to get more, and we use less, which makes the bottom line for us a lot better. It leaves dollars in our pockets.
Iowa's commitment to reduce their total farmland runoff by 45% will take additional efforts beyond using less fertilizer. Much of Iowa's rain-fed cropland is engineered to drain water as fast as possible. Water invariably laden with nitrogen and phosphorus and headed for trouble in the Gulf. Those out to stop the flood of farmland runoff into the Mississippi are now building a series of enormous organic filters, otherwise known as wetlands.
And these wetlands are placed below a farming watershed, and that water then sits in these wetlands for a short period of time. Those wetlands reduce the amount of nitrogen in that water. As that water leaves, it has 40 to 70% less nitrogen than it did as it came in.
All of these sites are on private lands. It's been very popular in Iowa, and we actually have a 2-year waiting list of landowners waiting to proceed with restorations of wetlands on their lands.
This area here, when it's flooded with water, will be, what, 27 to 37 acres,
yeah,
something like that.
It's got the patch.
Father and son dairy farmers, Doug and Herman DeWall, are part of a growing cadre of Iowa farmers turned wetland ambassadors.
It's going to take cooperation from a number of people, as well as state and federal help, to get this off the ground, because we've got to start someplace to get this going. We just can't go to work and start dumping water and have no responsibility or care about other people. Everybody's here. We need to all work on this project.
And there is some places where they may not be able to put one of these in, but maybe we can do a better job here and keep it back more so that the average will be down to where we need to be.
To achieve a 45% reduction in nitrate will require all of the nitrate reduction practices that we currently have available implemented fully across these landscapes to the extent that they're practical, plus about 2,000 to 3,000 of these nitrogen removal wetlands.
It turns out the farmers' workhorse wetlands are serving far higher purposes than mere water filters.
Oh, there they are. That's a pair of trumpeter swans. They came into the area about 3 years ago, the first pair. They've raised several offspring over the last 3 years, and the story was out that they might have been the first pair that nested outside of captivity in Boone County. And they've come back 3 years in a row, so I'm pretty proud of them. I've always thought that we got to do everything we can do to try to keep everything rolling and working, even if it's down in New Orleans. If it's our fault, we want to fix it.
Lifelong Iowan Jim McHugh jumped at the opportunity to establish a wetland on his farm, with a sense of stewardship reaching far beyond his property line.
I think I'm doing my part to help clean up the Mississippi, and it's only a little part, but at least it's a part.
Fewer tons of fertilizer, more acres of wetlands. All are lightening Iowa's agricultural burden on the Gulf of Mexico without burdening the returns of Iowa's farmers.
If you're interested in keeping your farm where the farm's supposed to be and not washing away, this is an excellent program. I highly recommend it. If you like wildlife, if you're thinking about conservation, give it a thought. Really give it a thought.
He's a fighter.
Got one, huh?
Got a fish on coming here. He's a big one, I think.
size redhead.
How big is he?
He looks about.
We need a healthy marine environment, and we need resilient coastlines. Increasing water quality, decreasing nutrient introduction, increasing and restoring and improving habitat function, all of those things build toward a healthy marine environment. And they don't need to come at the cost of economic development. If we can carry out the plans that we have put in place now, we will achieve those goals, and 20, 25 years from now, we'll be able to look back and say, boy, we really did a good thing.
Along the west coast of North America, from the northern tip of Vancouver Island to Baja California, runs a great and fertile ocean current. The California Current unites the coastal life of a continent, the flow of its waters connecting food webs and human communities for 2,000 miles. Under a single ecological umbrella. But the California Current also flows with increasingly familiar signs of degradation, challenging those who would begin to manage this massive ecosystem with a new perspective.
One of the concerns I have being here in Southern California is if you look at the plan for the United States for marine spatial planning, you've got the east coast of the U.S. broken into five different regions. On the west coast, we're one big region, you know. And so I think logistically, you know, trying to bring everybody together from a coastline that's so huge, it's going to be challenging.
It is a challenge now being met by a movement of marine stewardship stretching the length of the California Current. From the Southern California community of Ventura to the San Juan Islands of Washington, from beachfronts to forests to farm fields, people are re-examining their lifelines to the coast and sharing local solutions for sustaining them. And nowhere is this new commitment to ocean stewardship more intimately witnessed than in Port Orford, Oregon, where fishing runs in the blood.
When I was little, I guess 12 years old, and okay, on the weekends, Dad would take me fishing with him. Well, it was Sunday, you know, every Sunday morning, we're supposed to go to church. And I finally got to where, okay, you got an option here. You can either go to Sunday school or you can go fishing with me. Me in a little costume decorated up like an angel just wasn't getting it. There was no hands down about it. I'm going fishing.
Over the past decades, Port Orford's fishing community has felt unsettling shifts in its waters, in the decline of salmon and rockfish, and in the boom and bust of its urchin fishery. Disempowered and disenchanted by laws handed down from on high, the fishermen of Port Orford form the Port Orford Ocean Resource Team, or PORT, to give them a voice in preserving their marine environment. Port has developed a communal vision to sustain their fisheries and their ecosystem as one. It is a vision of hope, forged by hard times.
When my husband and I got married, we started rolling into a salmon disaster, you know, and then we had a groundfish disaster. We had the collapse of the urchin fishery here. It wasn't looking very good for our future, for even being able to stay and live here around our family that had been here, my family, since the early 1900s. I asked my husband, do you think we're going to be able to stay in fishing? Do you think this is going to work, or does there need to be a plan B? And he was very optimistic. He figured that he could, you know, continue to fish no matter what happened. And I felt like he had his head in the sand. I thought that, you know, basically things were not looking good for our community at all, especially because we're all small boat fishers. So we decided we were going to have to organize. And believe me, fishermen don't want to get organized. And yet, they did. They knew that it was going to be really important, so they put aside their really individualism that drove them in fishing to want to be out on the water by themselves. And they came to the table, and they said, what are we going to have to do to keep fishing and to make management better? What should our role be, and what could it be?
So that's what really kind of started me down this road. I wanted to have some voice in our future here, instead of letting, you know, other people tell us what our future is going to be. We wanted to be part of it.
You know, we needed to be proactive to manage our fisheries rather than respond to crises and be, you know, victim over and over and over.
So being at the table, a legitimate partner, and raising our concerns, and that's where the stewardship area comes in. We as partners have got to go up through that political ladder and get it done.
The Port Orford team didn't wait for the government to impose more regulations. They imposed their own. They designated their traditional fishing grounds as the Port Orford Community Stewardship Area, encompassing some 1,300 square miles of state and federal waters, as well as the upland watersheds that feed into them. Here, Port nurtures collaboration for conservation and resource management.
You know, just the fact that we had been on the ocean for all of those years and that many people for that long, we actually can propose some really valuable conservation measures based on what we know.
Okay, fish on!
And so what we're trying to do is use the local knowledge and the science together for conservation.
Port has initiated more than a dozen local science projects, mapping marine habitat at redfish rocks, using acoustic telemetry to track the movements of fish to determine the home ranges of species targeted for protection, and undertaking the region's first survey for seaweeds.
Even in this late collection, we still got 60 different species of seaweeds out there, and about 12 of them were new records to Oregon. And some of them may be new species, which we're quite excited about. So at one time I figured out that it took about 1,000 pounds of kelp to make 1 pound of salmon. And I thought, that's something people should learn about, because we all value salmon, but if we're gonna have salmon, we have to have things at the bottom of the food chain as well.
In an effort to ensure a more sustainable catch, the team is voluntarily releasing rockfish that are about to spawn.
We want to nip in the bud before there's a problem. How long can you go? How long can you catch all the big females?
Well, the problem is, it's going to be before, when they realize there's a problem, it's too late.
Right.
That's what always happens on all the fish. We'd like to address the problem and find out before and address it, so we don't have the problem.
And then it's going to be released.
That's where research reserves came in. We've gotten more scientific study in the last 4 years than we've gotten all my lifetime down here.
And we're going to get a lot more.
The deeper the team looked into the future of their fishery, the more they realized they needed to look beyond the sea. To protect their waters, ultimately, they would have to look to the land.
I'm Michael Murphy, the city administrator of the city of Port Arford. This is our bioswale project here. The idea of that is to take and collect all the storm water that comes off of this parking lot with about 100,000 vehicle visits per year. You can imagine there's quite a bit of pollutants that come in here. Comes in the storm drain here. After it goes through here, it works its way into this bioswale, and these plants and the soil microbes here detoxify and treat any toxic materials in the water. It helps to clean things up, remove the sedimentation. The purpose of the ordinance is to improve water quality. And we're one of the few communities that actually has a stormwater ordinance of this nature. The idea is to show people how simple it is to make a great improvement. And, you know, it doesn't cost a lot. It's not difficult. It's not expensive. It's fairly easy to do.
Aaron Longton, the president of the organization, and I conducted 176 hours of outreach for the Stormwater Ordinance from February to June of 2009. And the result of that extensive outreach was the ordinance being passed with not a single public comment against the ordinance.
And so if we can improve it here before it gets to the ocean, we've improved the ocean health. And the oceans have been under assault worldwide. It's nice to try to take care of that. So make a little difference in our own spot, and maybe others will do the same thing, and ultimately everything improves.
Upland here, we have beautiful watersheds that are in pretty good shape. One in particular that's got a lot of attention is the Elk River, which is the closest to our community here. It has a great run of fall salmon that we also depend upon here as a resource. There are a couple wilderness areas up in there that will benefit that ecosystem and keep it intact.
All right, buddy, you got it. Point your handle straight up.
One of the economic staples of Port Orford is the annual fall run of Chinook salmon. It is one of the strongest runs remaining on the West Coast.
It's an Elk River native Chinook, 30 pounds. We just caught it right here out of my friend Bill's hole. Oh, it was teamwork. He netted it, he did a great job. But what a battle. Isn't that a nice one?
The salmon that feed Port Orford spawn in the upper reaches of the Elk River. They are a living testament to the river's purity, to its clean, cold water, filtered and shaded by the high mountain forests.
Right along the wall.
While many of the coast's greatest salmon runs are no longer, their forests cut, their waters dammed or muddied by erosion, the Elk River salmon still run strong.
One of the best signs is lots of jacks. I mean, they're almost like a pest, there's so many. You can't even get your bait down to the big ones. Boy, that's a fat jack, isn't it? Mm.
And the townspeople of Port Orford have taken steps to keep it that way. In 2009, Port Orford made history when Elk River's upper watershed was designated as wilderness. The same year, with Port Orford's leadership, the underwater habitat known as Redfish Rocks became Oregon's first marine reserve. Soon after, the people of Port Orford gathered to celebrate their new ridge-to-reef wilderness.
This river, born of rocks in the Klamath and Siskiyou Mountains, flows freely to the sea. The Elk's green glow is lit from within. Once in a lifetime, perhaps, a river is loved and then protected. We celebrate today the gift of these green waters. Salmon and forest, settler and steward, like a water drop high in the mountains heads to the ocean, we too complete our journey. Today and forever, the elk stays wild and free. The river gods have spoken.
Yeah, we're here.
Jim, Jerry, hundreds of others. You listened deeply, and you listened well.
We needed to bury that tired old idea that loggers and fishing people and ranchers and environmentalists were on different sides. Those days are sort of over. It's clear that people can, from all of those different arenas, can come together and make good things happen, and that's what's going on here.
Port Orford, Elk River area is really interesting if you think about it. We have foresters here who have advocated for wilderness designation for forest, which puts it off limits for logging. So that's an interesting thing for a forester to do. And now we have fishermen, commercial fishermen, who are advocating special treatment for the ocean, respect for the resources. I think the change around here will come from the local people who have been here long enough to have a feel for the place and appreciate it and recognize how important it is to sort of turn the tide before there's nothing left to appreciate.
This is a community-based effort, and I'm not aware of any successful effort that really meets the triple bottom line, that advances the economy and preserves community values and a way of life and our natural environment, that doesn't start at the community level with local buy-in. So I think what you've done here is truly remarkable and is worth celebrating and is worth sharing across our state and across the nation.
We see clearly that jobs can go with conservation, that we can continue to fish, let's extract fish from the ocean and do it right, and have a conservation ethic around how we fish and still have our jobs and have our income for our families.
Okay, well, it's right here.
I'd like to look at this as kind of a generational aspect. I mean, like my father, there was never any question that there was an abundant timber, abundant fish. That was then, and this is now. And my son, he's going to be faced with different challenges. You know, nothing ever got done without one person having a great idea and moving it forward. So I just think everybody needs to be conscientious and work hard towards a better future. And if everybody is conscientious about it, then slowly things will move in a better direction.
There are many lessons for us to learn from these ocean pioneers. The first of which is that their success or failure is ours. We are all, in essence, ocean pioneers, steering uncharted waters in a sea of rapid change.
People were very happy with it.
It will take all of us to turn the tide on ocean frontiers from coast to coast. A new way of thinking, a new way of living, in concert with the sea, in consideration of those yet to come. Now is your opportunity to get involved.